Welcome to Club 10. It's great to have Jake Weitering back with us. We haven't spoken to Jake for a few weeks, but Jake, coming off a rare loss this year, Jake, how have you felt after the Fremantle game?
Yeah, frustrating. It's sort of, I guess, two times in the last 3 weeks that we've travelled and haven't been able to get the win. Freo's always, it's always going to be a tough contest. They're playing some great footy. They're second on the ladder for a reason. And unfortunately, we started quite well. It was an arm wrestle throughout the game, and they were just able to get a run on in sort of the third quarter and get a job done on us. So, again, frustrating, but to be 4-2 is, I guess, comforting in a sense. We're in the top eight, and we look towards North Melbourne this weekend.
So what did the review show this week? What are the things that you've got to work on?
There was a combination of things. We've probably got to find different ways to score. We're very, a very strong contested stoppage-based side. We defend quite well when we are winning stoppages, and there's the momentum swings as well. So there's a couple of things that we're going to be working on, moving the ball in different ways and probably getting more entries in the end. I think we only had 38 inside 50s or something of, you know, something similar to that on the weekend. So we've got to get Harry, we've got to get Charlie, Jack Martin, and hopefully Jack Silvani comes back this week, more supply. So we'll see how we go.
So how are you guys going with the ump dissent stuff? Is the message sunk through for everyone?
Yeah, we're pretty disciplined when it comes to that stuff. I think we'd be almost top two or three for the least amount of 50-minute penalties against this year. But the dissent one was something we talked about, certainly in reviews, previews going into game. There was a memo from the AFL that this was going to be targeted, I guess, in recent weeks. And for me, there was a free kick on the weekend. The first quarter, I went to sort of, you know, ask why, and I sort of just held my hands in as close as I could and just manned the mark. So you got to be smart with it. It's sort of a pattern at the moment, but hopefully some common sense comes into it. And we won't see free kicks like Dan McKenzie on the weekend.
So have you got trigger points to rein yourself in and cope with frustration and not be demonstrative?
I wouldn't say triggers, just maybe in the back of my mind that if I give away a 50-metre penalty, it's probably going to be a goal against. So the mistakes you make in my position usually cost me a goal, so I've got to be smart with that.
Yeah, well, still in the Anzac Day game, Grundy got one late and it virtually sealed the game.
Yeah, it's probably something...
Well, that wasn't for dissent, actually. That was just for manning the mark.
Yeah, but again, it's sort of the discipline of it. A lot of players would probably be training that as well, trying to get guys to shift off the mark, but it's the discipline to do it, the training of it, and there's always new rules that come into the AFL every year and you've got to make sure that you know them.
So Jake, I want to broaden the discussion out to how you defend different types of forwards. Like a Tom Hawkins would be a very different challenge, I imagine, to a Max King, for instance.
Yeah, it was a real nightmare playing on Harry and Charlie over the pre-season. I'll tell you that firsthand. But there's different, Hawkins is on 20-odd goals, I think, and Cameron's on 19. So guys are kicking plenty of goals at the moment and big bags. So you've got to find different ways to defend them and defend them for four quarters. So as you said, the guys with big levers like Max King, Harry, and even Mason Cox, who will be coming into Collingwood's team with Brodie Grundy out there, they're very tough to sort of stop from jumping. That's sort of the main aim, because they've got such long levers, and then you've got bigger guys, stronger guys like your Tom Hawkins, who you've got to be able to wrestle and understand when to hit them at the right moment and spoil it. So it's a tough job most weeks at the moment in the AFL.
And you'd be loving the fact as a key defender that the big forwards are kicking bags of goals. Why do you think that is? Because it's a part of the game that the fans certainly want to see. You don't, I get that, but are all the rule interpretation changes helping them now, do you think?
Yeah, big bags for my team would be good rather than against me. But the AFL is trying to shape a game that allows the spectator to enjoy it, and it's high paced, high scoring. It's probably less stoppages than in recent years. There's less numbers around the ball, the man on the mark rule, the 50 metre penalties, those sort of things. Not that they're intending to just make it, 150 to 140 each week, but it's entertaining. It's tough for defenders, but you've seen in the past as well, coaches and players have found ways to exploit certain rules and make scoring harder.
Well, the rule makers are essentially trying to outmaneuver the coaching panels, aren't they?
Yeah, you could probably say that. as I said, it's just it's a matter of trying to exploit rules and find a way to defend it. Not so much as an individual, but as a team. Team defence is so important nowadays.
Now, great shame for Mark Pittenett, who's just really established himself as a really, really good ruckman, and he's out for 2 or 3 months.
Yeah, for sure. Big Pitto, off the back of an amazing pre-season, he's certainly, I guess, broken onto the scene, I guess. He's been in the AFL for a long time now, and I think he was leading hitouts to advantage for the first 5 rounds or 6 rounds, and it's disappointing for him, but I know that he's the sort of guy, much like a Sam Docherty, who will mentor, lead, and do everything he can whilst he's on the sidelines rehabbing.
Well, Sam Docherty's probably no better example of determination and courage in the face of great adversity, is there, really?
No, for sure, and they'll lead by example, as I said, off the field, and help boys that are in rehab. And we've got another young ruckman as well. I guess it provides an opportunity for Tom DeConnelly to step up into, I guess, a 100% ruck role, and do a job for us.
North this week, and again, the McKay brothers seem very, very determined not to play on each other. What's going on?
Yeah, we've got a test this week. Any team that you come up against has always got to be a test, and you're going to respect them. But Harry and Ben seem pretty adamant on not playing each other, and I think Mum and Dad would be happy about that to date. But hopefully we see them at some point in the near future playing against
each other. Have they ever played on each other anywhere?
Not that I know of. I remember playing Gippsland in my top age year for TAC Cup, and I think Ben was down the other end. Harry was, they're obviously on the same team. So maybe in juniors, I'm not sure, but we haven't seen it at AFL level yet.
Oh, well, as always, next year for the McKay boys. Thanks very much for joining us again on Club 10, Jake, and good luck against the Roos on the weekend.
Cheers. Thanks, Rob.